Welcome. Nice to see smiling faces inside, even though it's pretty outside. Thank you for coming. This is another lecture, and I'm so excited to, in a minute, to introduce our speaker. But first, I have some exciting news, and it actually relates to what we're doing here. And this is a work in progress, that's still a work in progress, that we've been working on since we started the program. And now we have a website that has all of our videos, or will have all the videos. And so as you leave today, you can take some handouts with you. There are two versions of accessing this video, these videos. One version is just click a link and you're there. The other version is actually going to the website and use a password and so forth. So you can experiment to see which way works the best. And please give me feedback if you can't see them or they don't pull up, because I'm new at this. But I also did want to thank, I hope our camera girl doesn't fall over. Look familiar? I think you might be wearing the same top. So I want to say a big thank you to Catherine Luster. Now she's behind the camera again, you can't see her face. She has a private business, I Am Sandom Video, and she's just been a star, rock and roll star, helping me get these videos together and teaching me something I have no idea how to do. So thank you so much. Yeah. I wanted to introduce our speaker, Dr. Brad Lichtenstein, or Dr. Brad. I think there's a creative or poetic license to pronounce your name, kind of like my name, it's pronounced many different ways. He's a teacher, probably a philosopher of life. He is on the faculty and chair of Bastyr. He has a private practice. He's been doing a lot of fascinating things, teaching and guiding people for years. And he's going to teach us about breathing. So, please. Give a warm welcome.
Thank you. I don't usually use a microphone, so I'm going to use this for recording purposes, so let me know if I get too loud. I have some handouts. Can we?
Yeah.
We'll pass these out. So I'm excited to be here, and I'm going to be talking about one of my favorite topics, breath. So, I'm a naturopathic physician. I'm chair of our homeopathy department at Bastyr, and I supervise our clinical biofeedback department at Bastyr Clinic for Natural Health. And I became a naturopath because when I went to medical school, I was interested in exploring how can we heal with the least force. So many times when people think about naturopaths, we think about diet, we talk about nutrition, we talk about herbs, talk about homeopathy, at least I do, as the chair of the homeopathy department. But I'm really interested in how we can do the most basic things to heal. Now, we often talk about food, right? You've all heard lots of talks about food, correct? Did you know that we move in our lungs 35 pounds of air a day, which is more than the food intake we have every day? Now, in most people, you know, the physiology text, doctors teach us that normal breathing rate is between 14 to 18 breaths per minute, which if that's the case, that's greater than 23,000 breaths per day, which is greater than 8 million breaths per year. And I want to ask you, how many of you think about how you're breathing? We think about it when we're not breathing. You know, when we have difficulty breathing, we're like, okay, what's wrong with my breath? You know, and then we think about it, and then when we think about it, we often get more anxious, and then there's the problem. So normal physiology texts and normal, I was gonna say normal doctors, doctors, and I wasn't looking at you. And actually, this is the same for the naturopathic medical students, all the students. Most people learn from the MERT manual and basic physiology text, 14 to 18 breaths per minute is normal. And what I would like to say is that may be normal, but that isn't functional. So I want to talk about that, but I'd like to start by doing a meditation, if you will. And don't get scared, there's no test on this. And when I say meditation, it's really concentration, it's about focusing. How do you focus? So I'd like you to put your papers down for a moment. I'd like you to find a comfortable position. Now notice how you've been sitting. And a lot of times we get into what we think is comfortable, but it may not also be functional and healthy for us. So find a comfortable position. You don't have to look at me. I'm just going to be asking you certain questions. And I invite you to, if you can, and you might not be comfortable with this, and I'm looking around the room, putting both feet on the floor, not crossing the legs, if you can. And this is not an endurance contest, so don't worry. And you can just look down or close your eyes, that's fine. And if you'd like, I should have said this first, you can put one hand on your belly and one hand on your chest. You don't have to keep them there, but it can help in the process to help you become aware of how you're breathing. So that's what this is. It's an exploration of how we're breathing. So, I invite you just to breathe normally, and I do know that every time I say breathe normally, you already alter it when you focus on your breath. So that's okay. And I'm going to ask you a series of questions, and you don't have to answer yet. Just think about it. Now, the first set of questions are about the location of our breath, and that's why our hands are there. I'd like you to notice, where do you breathe first, or where is that first impulse when you breathe? It may not be where your body moves most. And if you have a hard time connecting with it, that's okay. See if you can feel that initial movement of the breath. What breathes first, I say. Now, its sister question is, what breathes most? So you might notice that the impulse starts in the belly, or the back, or in the chest. But you also might notice that what moves most is different. Now, I'm going to ask these questions again in a moment, and it might be different than it is right now. What moves first? What moves most? And part of this location question is also noticing whether you breathe in through your nose or your mouth. And you might ask yourself, is this a common pattern for me? And if you like, you can put your hands down now. There's still a few more questions. What moves first? What moves most? Where are you breathing in, through the nose or your mouth? The next set of questions are about the rate. What's the rate of your breath? Now, I'm not asking you to count it. I'm asking you to notice the inhale to the exhale. Is one longer? Is one shorter? Are they equal? The rate of inhale to exhale. Now, every single breath could be different. That's okay. Just notice. And notice now if there's any gaps or pauses in the breath. A gap happens midstream. So in the middle of the inhale, you catch. Or when you exhale, you might notice that. So a gap is in midstream, but a pause is at the end of the inhale or end of the exhale. And notice if there's a tendency. So any gaps or pauses. And notice, what's the quality of the breath? Is it smooth or is it staccato? Does the inhale flow into the exhale? Does the exhale flow into the inhale? Movements of the breath? Do you find that every other breath you have to take a deeper breath, sigh, yawn? I've already noticed 7 people yawning. You're not alone. Do you find that your breath catches or skips? So just a few more questions. What is the physical and emotional quality of this breath? What does that question mean? If you were watching someone breathe the way you're doing right now, do they seem anxious, relaxed, comfortable, exhausted? And finally, I want you to scan your body from your jaw, lips, tongue, forehead, to neck, to shoulders, to chest, even your groin and pelvis and buttocks and thighs. Is there any muscular tension that's preventing free-flowing breath? How many of you are tightening your jaw, your lips? How's your pelvis? How are the thighs? So I'm going to go over these questions one more time. First, location. Notice if you're breathing through your nose or your mouth. Notice what moves first, what moves most. What's the quality of the breath? And look at the, is it smooth? Is it flowing? Or is it staccato and jerky? Look at the rate of your breath, the inhale to exhale. Is one longer or shorter or equal? Are there any gaps or pauses? And is there any emotional tension with this breath? And any physical tension? Okay. Thank you for indulging me. I invite you to come back, open your eyes. And notice what happens when we sit and do a meditation. Every class I teach, everywhere, that I teach at best here, so I've been doing that for 15, 16 years, and I always start with a meditation. I ring my bell. It's a Pavlovian response. I ring the bell, the students sit up, and then do this. Some people can tell you that I do this at all my classes. And then I ring the bell again when we're done, and the students do this. And I promise you, the way you hold your body and the way you breathe can increase your alertness and awakeness and attention, and decrease it too. So sitting like this, the standard American posture, as I call it. You know, we talk about the standard American diet, the standard American posture. We sit over our computers, and then we do like this at the end of the night, and then we go, why can't I stand up? And it's not necessarily because of aging. It's because for 20,000 years we've been doing this, and then we can't stand up. So notice what happens when you're sitting here. So let's go back to these questions. I first asked, what moves first and what moves most? What did you guys notice? There's no wrong answers, and nobody else knows your answer. What'd you notice?
I felt it between my ribs.
You felt it between your ribs?
Yeah.
Right down there. Okay. Moving most and moving first?
Maybe my chest moving most, but between my ribs first.
And I'll just tell you, if you don't mind, I'm just not picking on you. I'll pick on all of you. That you said that, and when you said, maybe, and you took a breath in, I noticed this part moves most when you said that. So you felt this, but there's also something here. What else did you notice?
Stomach.
Okay, here's an easier way to do this. How many felt your chest move most? How many felt the belly move most? Okay, all right. Now, the question I have for you, is that how it is most of the time, or is that only when we're sitting here in this nice room, relaxing and sitting upright? So that's something to think about. Now, the question about location, I was watching, everyone seemed to breathe in and out through your nose, so that's good. I just want to be clear that nose breathing, nostril breathing, is the way we're designed. That nostril breathing is important because it warms, moistens, and filters the air. When you start to breathe in through your mouth, and think about this if you're outside on a cold, a cold East Coast day. I'm from the East Coast, we're in Boston, it's really cold and dry, and you know, you go outside and go, and you feel your whole body contract because cold, dry, and unfiltered air makes the respiratory tract contract. You know, it makes the lungs and bronchi start to constrict. So we want to warm, moisten, and filter the air, and the other thing it does is it also slows it down. Okay, so let's talk about the inhale to exhale. What did you notice? Was one longer? How many people had a longer inhale than exhale? Okay. How many felt that the exhale was a lot longer? Anybody feel it was equal? Okay. And we're going to talk about some of the aspects of functional breathing. I know it's not these hard and fast rules, but this is, I don't want to say good breathing and bad breathing. I want to say functional breathing. Okay. And how many of you are noticing, even as you're listening to me, that you're tightening certain parts of your body? Jaw, lips, think about your tongue. Tight, mouth, tight, how do you soften all that? So this breath inquiry is something that we do with all our patients in the biofeedback shift. Almost everyone that comes to the biofeedback shift at Best Year, we go through this because breathing is one of the most fundamental things. And we work with people from a variety of conditions, asthma, IBS, PTSD, you name it, chronic pain, and we teach breathing. So I have a handout there, and you can look at your handout. Actually, I can look at my handout too. Many people don't think about breathing. And as I said in the beginning, we spend so much time talking about what we put into our body and good foods and bad foods and healthy foods. But if you look on that first page, there's a number of conditions and symptoms that are linked to dysfunctional breathing. And it's quite astounding, the number of things. When we talk about our breathing, we're not only talking about the physiological issues, we're talking about biochemical issues that happen with breathing, and also psycho-emotional issues. But if you look at that list, you can see elevated and erratic heart rate, palpitations. You can see pain, chronic migraines, TMJ. All of this can be linked to improper breathing, even chronic upper respiratory infections linked to improper breathing. And I'm here to say, and I know I'm going to be on video, that if you have essential hypertension, and I'm talking about hypertension that's not related to any other diseases, not due to kidney disease, not due to congestive heart failure, not due to certain medications, but if you have just essential hypertension, more than food, and I'm a naturopath, I believe breathing is the key. I think that breathing is the thing, because we've had patients, just this week, we had three patients. One walked into the office with a blood pressure of 190 over 100. And after 20 minutes of breathing, it was down to 110. And I have tons of stories, and I'm not trying to say, oh, this is the miracle thing. Because the problem with that is, you know, she could get off her medications, but if she doesn't practice her breathing, it's not going to help. So, as you can see, there's a host of things, IBS, ulcerative colitis, that can be linked to improper breathing. So on the next page, you can see that there's a breathing inquiry. This is what we just did. We looked at location, rate, volume. I forgot to mention volume. So what I'm going to ask you now is, when you're going to say what is good, healthy breathing, what do you think healthy breathing should be like? I just want to hear what some of our attitudes are and our beliefs about this.
What do you think? A complete inhale and a complete exhale.
A complete, and what does complete inhale and exhale mean? Complete.
I don't know.
That's okay.
Doctor.
No, but I'm glad you say that, because people come in, and I also tell you, I'm teaching students and medical doctors this too. So we have these ideas about, like, what is a complete? So let me ask. Yeah.
Okay. I was just going to say, for me, it's to take a complete breath, to, in my opinion.
Yeah, yeah.
A complete breath. Pause just for a second and then exhale.
Okay.
That's my definition.
Great. We'll look at that. Thank you. What else do you think? Other ideas about what?
It needs to be low.
It needs to be low.
Can't be up.
Not up in the chest.
Yes.
Okay. What else? I know I'm putting you on the spot.
Smooth.
Smooth. And how do you define smooth? Just like
not
the complete.
Erratic or.
Not erratic. So. If I may, like, inhale just flows into the exhale, and exhale flows. Okay. I might not have anything to teach you guys. What else?
Regular.
Regular. What do you mean by that?
I mean, not short amounts worth of breath, and then longer and shorter.
Ah. So not a...
Yeah. And then no breathing.
Exactly. Okay. So regular, smooth, low. Anything else?
I see it as matching my activity.
Ah, now that's something that I didn't mention, and I should start with that, matching your activity. What I'm talking about in functional breathing, and this is extremely important, it's about metabolic demand. It's about metabolic need. I don't know why I was going to say this, if the fire alarm went off, let's not think that. If all of a sudden you have to run down the flight of steps, or just walk down the flight of steps because the elevator's not working, your breathing rate changes. Your breathing rate changes. It needs to. Your blood pressure has to increase. All of these things happen. What I'm talking about for functional breathing is what most of us do most of the day. Now, unless we're doing a lot of physical labor, and in the modern society we're not, just for this period of time, this is what we're talking about. But our metabolic demand is low. So, matches metabolic need. That's an extremely important thing. Any other ones?
I was going to say, hopefully effortless.
Hopefully effortless. And when I do this with patients and I start teaching them how to breathe, a lot of times it takes some effort because you're learning a new response. I posit, I tell patients, students, I really believe it's not that complicated to be peaceful. Now, I don't want to use the word happy because, you know, happy, I think, connotes so many things. You know, if I get that job, I'll be happy. If I had $10 million, I'd be happy. I always want to say in my traditional Jewish way, let me find out, give me the $10 million, maybe. My father says that all the time. And I'll get back to you. If anyone wants to try that experiment with me, I'm ready. You know, I think my email's on the front. But happiness is not about that. It's about being at peace. How can we be okay with whatever happens? And so that's what I'm exploring. And for me, now, in my practice, I have said I have never helped someone lose weight. I'm not interested in that. I'm interested in exploring how you find peace. Because I think when we do that, so many things will change. And then we could look at, you know, and sometimes we can't find peace because we are eating so much sugar that is addictive, or we're doing other practices. But how do we find peace in it? For me, the breath is the key. How do we start doing this? So, I think that if we want to be peaceful, we have to practice it. What are we practicing to be peaceful? This is really what I believe. So it can be an effort initially because you want to learn a new way of being. So let's talk about this. And I think it's on the next page. It's not on the next page. What's on the next two pages is something about oxygen. Let me go there first. I want to ask a question about the inhale to exhale. What do we think is functional or healthy for inhale to exhale ratio? You know, when you inhale and exhale. Anybody have an idea?
50-50. 1 to 4.
Okay, there's a lot of ideas out there. How many think, just intuitively, that the inhale should be larger, or that it's functional for the inhale to be bigger than the exhale? Okay. How many of us think, for most of us, and again, I'm not talking about with someone with COPD or asthma, actually I am talking about someone for asthma, but for congestive heart failure or kidney disease, how many think that oxygen is the big culprit in breathing, that we need to get more oxygen? It actually is not one of the most important parts. Most people, again, it depends on medications and certain diseases, but most of us, you know, functional people, we don't have to worry about getting too much air, and that's what we do. The first thing we do when we talk about someone who's stressed is say, take a breath, breathe, breathe. What does acute hyperventilation look like? You all know this idea. What's it, you know? I think of that Burt Reynolds movie. I can't remember. He's hyperventilating in the store somewhere. It was in the 70s. And somebody says, does anybody have a Valium? And like seven people all do this. Such a 70s movie. But what's acute hyperventilation look like? Fast. Fast. And what's the treatment?
A brown paper bag,
yes. I said spontaneously to a class, I said, oh, a plastic bag. And they all looked at me and said, oh no, not plastic, a paper bag, right. And when you do, well, actually, if you use a plastic bag, that will stop the problem. Yeah. If you use a paper bag, what are you doing? You're what?
You're rebreathing.
And you're breathing
mostly carbon dioxide. And carbon dioxide, when you breathe in carbon dioxide, what it will do is it actually will cause the tissues to relax. People don't know this, but when you have too much oxygen in the bloodstream, the hemoglobin, the red parts of the red blood cell that carries the oxygen around, the bonds between the oxygen and the hemoglobin, when the oxygen saturation goes up, gets tighter, and it doesn't want to release. It sounds like it's counterintuitive to how we were designed, but we're also, you know, animals don't usually have stress response. You don't usually see, you know, you talk to your cat and you say, hey, I have to pay the mortgage, and it doesn't usually go. It just looks at you and goes, meow, and then walks off. But yet us, we humans, we start thinking about things and it affects our breathing instantly. And so there's acute hyperventilation, but most of us don't know about chronic hyperventilation. And chronic hyperventilation is where we overbreathe, like in an acute condition, but it doesn't look like. Chronic hyperventilation is simply getting rid of too much oxygen rapidly. Or too much CO2 rapidly. Sorry, I knew that didn't make sense after I said it. Too much CO2 rapidly. Or breathing in too much oxygen. Does that look like any of you? Any think about this? You know, do you ever go? I mean, the metaphor for this is hide and go seek. You know, when you're playing hide and go seek, what does everyone do? They go, Johnny's coming. Nobody ever says, oh, Johnny's coming around the corner. Nobody does that. They all go, So that's hide and go seek when we're playing in some game. But how many of us do that with mortgage? Oh, Bill, oh, that report. Or, God, I ate that. Oh, I have to go tell my doctor I ate that. If we do this all the time, we're increasing our oxygen and changing our CO2 concentration, and it causes our blood pressure to go up, because it causes tissues to constrict. And I can go into the whole biochemistry, and some of it is explained on page 4, just some of it.
I was going to do a PowerPoint presentation. I thought it was going to just be too much like being in a class.
So when we overbreathe, we actually increase blood pressure, cardiac output, and the interesting thing, there's something called the Haldane-Bohr effect and all these other scientific names. It shifts our pH. And it actually causes nerves to be more excitable. So it causes increased chronic pain. It causes muscle cells to depolarize faster, causing more constriction. So how we breathe and the amount of oxygen and CO2 you take in can increase our symptoms. And so some of that is explained there, just very briefly. So notice how you breathe. The worst thing you can tell to somebody who's anxious is, take a deep breath, take a deep breath. Because every time you breathe in, actually, you stimulate your sympathetic nervous system. Your parasympathetic, the rest and digest. You know, if you talk about stress eating,
I don't know if anybody's ever had that, because I don't know anybody who's ever had that, you know, it's like.
Stressed eating, when you're stressed, it's not about the eating part, it's about the stress part. How do you deal with the stress part? Well, if we're going, if you want to do a mini biofeedback experiment, I'm not sure if everybody's really good at feeling your pulse, but we could do this right now. If you can feel your radial pulse, your pulse on your wrist, if you can't feel that one, you can always feel your carotid, but the radial pulse is great. And let's just notice, I want you to feel the beats and about the space between. You're not counting. You're just feeling about the rhythm and the smoothness of the pulse. And now,
I'm going to tell you to dysfunctionally breathe.
Take a big breath in and hold it. And watch what happens to the pulse. Hold it. Hold it. Now slowly exhale it like Connie. Do you feel a change in the pulse? Some of you may not, depending on if you're on medications, that can affect it. But do that a few more times, just one or two more times. Take a deep breath in and hold it. Feel what happens to your pulse. This is a normal physiological response. It should speed up, and then when you exhale slowly,
You should feel it slow down. Here's part of the key to stress reduction. Slowing down your breath, slowing down the exhale, and it will slow down your pulse and hence your blood pressure. Now, I'm not going to advocate anybody take that deep breath in, hold it, and then slow it down. Andrew Weil has a whole breathing technique where he has you hold it, take a breath in, hold it for several seconds, and then blow out. I think it's like 4, 5, 7 or something. And that does stimulate the heart, but slows it down. I'm going to not advocate for that for everybody because that may not be the best thing. So can you feel that? Did you feel the change in pulse? You just did a mini biofeedback exercise. So it's something called, I think I said, respiratory sinus arrhythmia. It's a normal physiological arrhythmia that as you inhale, your pulse goes up, and as you exhale, your pulse goes down. So this is part of, there's several factors in it. Part of it is the CO2, O2 concentration. Some of it is different parts of your body, the baroreceptors that get stimulated. There's a number of things. But really important. So do you see, you can change your health, your physiology just by breathing. On page 5, and I didn't bring pens, and page 5 is this Nijmegen questionnaire. Before I worked with my mentor in biofeedback, I read about the Nijmegen questionnaire, and I kept calling it the Nijmegen questionnaire. And I remember I met him at this conference, and I went up to him, and I said, yes, I was using the Nijmegen questionnaire with somebody. And he went, oh. I was like, oh, that's not what it's called. And I held my breath.
Isn't it named after, there's a town in the Netherlands?
Yes.
Okay.
The guy is from the Netherlands.
Okay.
Yeah, and I'm making a questionnaire. It has a 95% accuracy rate of predicting chronic hyperventilation syndrome. I encourage you at some point to do this. Some of my patients have said, well, what do you mean by rare? How many is rare? They're basic neurological symptoms that can result from over-breathing. So if you have a score of greater than 23, you may be a chronic hyperventilator. So it might be something to look at. And if you have hypertension or asthma, insomnia, TMJ, chronic headaches, IBS, and you have a score greater than 23, I would like to suggest to you, you might be able to change some of those things through breathing. Now, what I didn't say is several things affect our breathing drive. Hormones affect our breathing drive. Food affects our breathing drive. Have 14 cups of coffee, you will overbreathe. Sugar affects our breathing drive. Sodas affect our breathing. I mean, there's a number of things, and there's a number of medications that affect our breathing drives. So it's not just as simple as just changing your breath. Hormones change our breathing drive. It's very interesting. In naturopathic medicine, one of the treatments for anxiety is GABA, amino acid. Well, it's interesting, if you look in the research, GABA slows down the breathing drive. I'd like to also suggest that maybe anxiety is not a psycho-emotional issue. I'm wondering if anxiety could also be a physiological one. You change your breath, you will change your emotions. In biofeedback, that's what we do. We go from the bottom up, from the body up. I'm just throwing some things out there. I want you to start thinking about them. So you might want to take your Nijmegen questionnaire and look at that. So on the next page, here's the stuff. Here's the key of all the work I do. It's the components of functional breathing. And I have 7. There's really 8. And some of you already got this, so you might know this already. So the first thing I said is the location, the placement. What is functional? I'm trying to get away from the word should. What is functional is through the nose. So my father, for an example, he was in a car accident. He was in a car accident where he was in the hospital for weeks because he shattered his face, his nose broke, bones of his face broke, his collarbone. A drunk driver hit him on Christmas Eve at 10 in the morning, coming home from party, and hit the person behind him. And that woman, I know this is not about it, but that interestingly, that woman, her father and brother were killed by drunk drivers. Well, back to the breathing part. Notice how you were breathing when I said that. My father never had hypertension. My family has no history of hypertension. He never had hypertension a day in his life, wasn't on medication. He had two or three nostril surgeries because he couldn't breathe through his mouth, I mean through his nose, and he still can't. I mean, he has a lot of problems. And ever since then, he has high blood pressure, and I really believe that if you can't breathe through your nose, that's gonna cause a problem. You know, I know a lot of doctors will say, oh, you have a deviated septum. Everybody has a deviated septum. You know, so the degree to it, if you have it to a degree that's a problem, then I think that we need to look at those things. So through the nose, and I already explained, warms, moistens, filters, and slows down the breath. The second thing is the placement, somebody already said, again, based on metabolic need, diaphragmatic, low. And I'm gonna teach you how to find diaphragmatic and low breath in a moment. So if you go to yoga classes or Pilates classes and they'll teach you, you know, you wanted a full yogic breath, no. If you're in a yoga class, you might want a full yogic breath. But while you're sitting here, you do not need to go. Nor do you need to make those noises. And if you do make those noises, that might be an issue too. So you don't need a big breath. So that's another aspect of this. Under volume, on number four, it needs to be shallow. It doesn't need to be a large breath of air because the metabolic demand is not great. So a lot of us think we need to go. No. Diaphragmatic or belly. Those are slightly different. I'm not gonna split hairs with you guys. Just down here. And when you're breathing, the chest doesn't need to move. When the chest moves, now the sternum can move a little bit, but when the collarbones lift, that's because we're trying to increase space in here. You know, the fitness industry has really done a number on all of us. None of us like our bodies. I mean, we all have body image dysmorphia. I mean, I don't know who doesn't. Because you know, we have to look at like certain fitness magazines. And if you look at the fitness magazines, everybody has tight abs. And I say to patients, you can have tight abs or you can be healthy. I've had patients that I'm working with and they'll put a pillow, they literally put more than two or three, many of them put a pillow in front of them and say, I don't want you to see my belly move when I'm breathing. I know I'm supposed to let my belly move, but I don't want you to see it. I said, okay, you don't have to move your belly or you can be healthy. And I really don't think it's that complicated. It really is. Move this belly. It's designed to move. Because the diaphragm, this dome-shaped muscle that's right here, could have pictures of this, it goes down into the belly when you breathe. And if it doesn't go down, and you can prevent it from going down, this has to move. And in order for this to move, because the volume of the lungs has to change, so the pressure, so the air can flow in. If this doesn't move, you're going to use other muscles. And if you use other muscles all day long, you will be fatigued. Some of your fatigue can be due to posture. This is why I think every single person needs a massage every day of their life. Can you write a prescription for that? Starting with you, yeah, exactly. Because it's not about wellness, but. So think about this. You know, I said the standard American posture. You know, one of the things that's worse for us, and I know we're all doing it, on my shift, we're not allowed to do this. You cross your legs, you tilt your pelvis, then your eyes always want to be level. So you're going to do all these contortions so that you can keep your head up. And then we do this one, and then we do this one. I do this. I mean, I come home at night. I know this. I've said this to students all the time. I come home at night and I say, I'm on sofa. And I sit there and I say to myself, get up, Red. Get up. It's like, I'm too tired. I was like, no, that's dysfunctional. So we're not allowed to cross our legs. And I have patients who, I come into the treatment room with the students, I supervise students, and I remember one day I did this, and this woman leaned over and snapped me, and she said, if I'm not allowed to do it, you're not allowed to do it. I said, okay. And then the other day I went like this, just stretch it. So, but here's what I was gonna say about the posture. When we sit like this, we put our rib cage on our belly. The diaphragm can't move. So we use these accessory muscles that are not designed in the long term to make us breathe. By the way, most chairs, if I can say this, suck. Sit on an airplane. No one is built like that. Sit in even the chairs at our Bastyr clinic. I'm on tape. Put our pelvis in a position that compromises our health. It really does. So it's not you, It's the chair of a manufacturing company. But when you sit in a certain way, you are going to use your accessory muscles and you'll be fatigued. So part of this is postural. And notice, how do you do that? You know, those balls that people sit on are really great. It would look weird to go to a movie theater with like 75 balls all around your room. So we're looking at location, diaphragmatic, and we're going to teach this in just a second. Look at how your posture is. I said through the nose, diaphragmatic, shallow. And so I already mentioned that. It doesn't have to be a large volume of air. The next one is slow. There is a myth about what is normal, 14 to 18, 14 to 20 breaths per minute. And I'd like to say that the research suggests that functional is 6 breaths per minute. And a lot of people go, really, 6 breaths? That, you know, if they're telling me 14, now you're going to cut it in half. Some of the best research was actually in showing this biofeedback device for the first FDA-approved biofeedback device for essential hypertension. It's called the Respirate, $250. If you have a smartphone, or if you have something like that, you know those things? It's called a clock, it has a second hand. You don't need the Respirate. If you know how to tell time and count, you don't need it. But you can make a lot of money by making these things. 6 breaths per minute is a 10-second breath. That's 5 seconds in, 5 seconds out. And we're going to do something with that in just a moment. Get away. The inhale to exhale ratio, inhale should never be longer. As we already talked about, that when you inhale, it stimulates the sympathetic nervous system. When you exhale, you stimulate the parasympathetic. This is actually the reason why 14 to 18 breaths per minute is not functional. Because what you're doing is you're stimulating your vagus nerve that helps stimulate parasympathetic response. Never gets fully, it's like the vagus break. You never get to really press down on that vagus nerve. So when you breathe slower, you have more time to push down the parasympathetic. So inhale should never be longer than exhale. Inhale and exhale can be equal. Exhale could be longer. But if you're breathing, you're chronically hyperventilating. I just realized I didn't say something about chronic hyperventilation syndrome. What it looks like is that studies with medical students show that you ask them a question, they go, but my work with patients, and of course it's a select population. I'm working with people who come in with stress-related complaints, which is about everybody, but you ask them a question, they're always holding their breath. So chronic hyperventilation looks like holding your breath, looks like frequent sighing. Looks like never really getting the breath out. And what I saw 7 people do when you slowed your breathing down. I'm trying to see if I can make other people yawn. Frequent yawning. Yes, we're tired because our whole culture's tired. But we often do that because we're trying to regulate and get rid of that. So it's much more complicated than pH, CO2, O2 concentration. I could explain that, but that would be another 3 hours. But yawning is another sign of chronic hyperventilation syndrome. And the last thing is silent. The breath should be silent. We shouldn't need to make a lot of sound. So I know some people who've done yoga know ujjayi breath. You may have heard of that. Ujjayi breath in the Upanishads, the original works, talked about that it should be so silent nobody else can hear it. And you go to these yoga classes and you hear everybody going, that's too much constriction in your throat. That's too much constriction. That's tension. We're trying to be free from tension. So silent breathing. And the last thing that's not on here that somebody said, can't remember, smooth. It should be flowing. It should just go right to the next. So the exhale could extend. There could be a little pause, but it should be smooth and consistent. So, with the last few moments, I'm going to put this down because I want to teach some exercises. Just 2. How do you find the diaphragmatic breath? How do you find the diaphragm? It's really simple, you know? And there's 2 methods that can really help you feel diaphragmatic breath. The first, and I'm doing this sitting because you're all sitting, and most of the day, aren't we sitting? That can be part of the problem. coming to the edge of your chair, if that's comfortable. If you need to sit back, that's fine. And notice how your pelvis is. Are you tilting your pelvis forward? Is it, you know, if the pelvis is like a bowl, is it spilling forward? Are you sitting on your tailbone, which a lot of people do? I do when I get home. Is it tilted to one side? So just, you know, feel your pelvis. You have free permission to move your pelvis, okay? Then, notice that your ribs aren't arching forward. And then I invite you to bring your hands to your lower ribs. So I'll stand so you can see. Here's the bottom of my ribs. So it's right here. Now, notice where your shoulders are. So some of this might be, yeah, there is a problem sometimes if you're elbowing your neighbor. You don't want your shoulders up by your ears. They're not earrings. Roll them down. You just bring them up for a little bit and then drop them. And then squeeze into your ribs. When you squeeze into, and I'm really pushing. When I push into my ribs and relax my shoulders and jaw and lips and tongue, tons of things to think about. Now move your hands with your breath. The tactile stimulation can help. Now try to keep your chest motionless. See my hands. I was going to say, don't try this at home. No, please try this at home. Now I can isolate them. I've been doing this for a long time. Can you make it silent, not move your chest, and just feel the movement of the ribs? You might also feel the belly move. And remember, that's good. You know, all those magazines where everybody's like this, nobody walks around like this. You want us to move. Now, some people can feel the diaphragm and diaphragmatic and belly breath really easily like this. It's about 50-50 from my experience. Another way to do this is arms over the head. And what that is simply taking your hands and bringing your arms up. And if that's too much, you can hold your elbows. When your arms are straight up and the humerus is perpendicular to your clavicle, it locks this up. Now notice, are your shoulders up? Drop your shoulders at the same time. I know it's a lot. This may be too difficult for some people, so don't bother doing that. You can hold them there. Now breathe. Can you feel it? Now, here's the homework. Breathe this way, and then lower the arms, and see if you can still feel that movement. If you start to lose it, go back to this, or this. So I think it says in the handout, because this is instructions, this is what I give our patients. I think the instructions are to do one of those, or both of those, and do it for 7 breaths. Feel 7 breaths, so you can get that. And then lower your hands and see if you can get that sensation. What we're trying to do is create a new memory, a new somatic visceral memory of functional breathing. It's very challenging. Especially if you've been breathing for a while, and you've all been doing it. And you are excellent students at learning the dysfunctional way of doing it. So the last thing I want to do, I'm doing this really quickly, and I want you to know that this is like 3 sessions of what we do in biofeedback. But the last thing I want to do is use the clock. There's all kinds of pacers. I have pacers on my iPhone and my iPad. But again, it's really simple. And what we're going to do, and I want you to try this. Now remember our rules. We're breathing low in the belly. We're breathing not a lot of air. So you could do this exercise with your arms overhead or right here. And we're going to count the breath. We're not going to take a big breath. We're going to breathe in for 5 seconds. Now here's the guidelines. We're going to inhale for 5 seconds and exhale for 5 seconds. If you feel like after 2 seconds you go, pause. I know I said no pause on the inhale, but that's okay here. You know, pause, and then exhale. Catch it on the next part, and I'm gonna count for you. I'm gonna say in and out, so you don't have to look at the clock, but you can face forward. Now, the other thing is, if you start to get lightheaded or dizzy, you are breathing too much air. If you get lightheaded and dizzy, this is what you're doing. Ready? And it could be in 2 seconds. You could just, in 2 seconds, you could go. Imagine sipping in honey. Imagine it's slow. So I can breathe for 5 seconds by just doing this. See how slow that goes?
I've been doing this for years.
And you can do this. Now, I don't know the audience. I don't know what your conditions are. If you have congestive heart failure, if you have kidney disease, frank kidney disease, those are the main two. This will be challenging for you. Not, this isn't terrible for you, but it may be challenging for you. So let's just notice, and if you're on hypertensive medication, be cautious, because this is definitely something you have to regulate, because we've had patients go hypotensive. So it's something to start to learn. So finding that comfortable position, hands here, hands overhead, or if you don't, you don't even need to do that, if you can feel the belly move, you can. And I'm gonna say inhale, and I'm gonna say when to exhale. And we're doing it through the nose, silently. Try and make it slow. So exhaling your air, and we're gonna begin in two. And inhale. Yep, and exhale. Keep it going, pause if you need to. Inhale. Try to keep a small volume of air, and exhale. Yep, it takes some time. And inhale, you can pause anytime you need to, and wait for the exhale. We're gonna just do this for a little bit more. And inhale, just 30 seconds more. And exhale, relax your jaw, your forehead. And inhale. And exhale. Just one more round. Just for the next few seconds, just notice. Now try to just breathe on your own. And notice what that's like. Notice how your body feels. If you thought you never could do meditation and you just did that, that's a meditation. It's a counting meditation. But that's meditation. It's focusing. How do you feel in your body? How do you feel in your mind? How do you feel emotionally? So I just want to end, and then have some questions. But I just want to end by reminding us about the word inspiration, inspiratus. It comes from spiratus, it comes from spirit. And this is how I define it. It's breathing in life, breathing in spirit, if you will. And I talk about this all the time. How many of us are so terrified of breathing in life? You know, it's too much. So we hold our breath. And expiratus is not to die. It's to put our spirit back into the world. And how many of us are so terrified of being seen, of being judged, of being criticized? You don't have to raise your hand, because there's probably every single person in this room that has that. I know I do. So we don't breathe in and we don't breathe out. Breathing is a metaphor for how we live our life. So I'm just excited to always share this with people because I think this is the thing in principle in medicine is first do no harm. Primum non nocere. If we can learn to breathe on an emotional level, on a physical level, I think it would change your health. Could you imagine if the planet, everybody just decided to breathe before they did a lot of things. So any questions, any thoughts? I know there's a ton of stuff, that's why there's the handout. Any questions at all? Yeah?
So is breathing exercise that we did, is that something you could use when you're trying to quiet your mind at night to go to sleep?
Yes, is this breathing exercise something you can do at night to quiet your mind? Most definitely. And I pick 6 breaths per minute. What the research suggests is it can be anywhere from 4 to 8 breaths per minute could be ideal for each individual. But it's that range. I pick 6 because we're working with a number of people. There's ways to test this. I have machines to test what happens to your body. When I tell people about breath retraining, and some people will say, I do it at night, you know, Dr. Brown, I'm not getting through my exercises because I fall asleep. I say, that's great. Use one of your times before bed.
But do it another time when you're sitting upright so that you can actually train your body to remember. But it is something to calm your mind and calm your body and just focus on that. It will actually get you out of that limbic system, amygdala, fight response when you feel what's going on in your body. And it can be difficult at times. Any other questions? Thoughts? How many of you feel more relaxed now? How many feel more stressed? Some people do. People with asthma specifically have a very hard time with this exercise, and it's really helpful for them. So thank you for letting me breathe with you.
Thank you.
I think my contact information is on the front of that, so if you have any questions that come up, let me know.
Thank you so much. That was wonderful. I'm hearkening back to when we had a hypnotherapist here, and I had to get up out of my chair at the end and say thank you. I almost didn't make it. So I'm very jello, but this is wonderful. It just dovetails to all these things we're really trying to accomplish with the program. This is an advertisement. I'm going to give you a little preview of next month's lecture. I normally don't do this because next month is our one-year anniversary. Hurrah! So instead of a lecture, no slides, actually maybe fun slides, we're going to have a party.
Yeah!
So, that's what I'm talking about. So we're going to get invitations out to you soon. It's going to be a potluck-ish type party. Remember the plate method? So kind of fun things to think about to bring. We'll give you instructions. Not only food and beverage, we'll have a little video booth manned by that lady back there who will maybe ask you some questions. You can toot your horn and say what's been fun and what's been nice about the program. We'll have someone in a little massage chair, 15-minute chair massages, so that sounds great. And a guitar singing duo with, what's their tagline? It's cocktail folk lounge music, something like that. So, but it'll be fun, and I hope you all can come, so thank you.